Hi there. How are you doing? So, yes, like you said, I do stuff as Weirdcore, and yeah, I don't really know how to, how to describe it other than it's really not corporate at all, basically. So, yeah, I'll just show you a few bits and bobs of what I've done in the past, and So, this is something I did for Radiohead last year, and yeah, this is really chilled to my standard. But I thought I'd loosen you up with something easy before I assault you with other stuff. Yeah, I really like this one. It's really short, and I really like the campaign that they did because it was just loads of bite-sized stuff, and I think it's a future for music videos because, yeah, it just works a lot better for the social media thing. This is much more my vibe for 3D. So you get the vibe, yeah? This is more my vibe for 2D stuff. Stuff I did for Miley Cyrus and did it with Dying Martell. Then this, which I did with Jake Chapman from the Chapman Brothers, and the music, or the sounds, should I say, by Russell Haswell. And this kind of sums up as to, well, it's pretty amazing that you can get commissioned and this gets broadcasted on national TV, really. And then this. And then I did this thing recently, and I watched it for the first time in ages, like when I was doing this keynote, and it was pretty mad to think that there was not that long ago we thought he was actually going to lose, but
So a man who can be provoked by a tweet should not have his fingers anywhere near the nuclear code. Make it a sneak attack. If there were nuclear war in East Asia, well, you know, that's fine, you know, have a good time, folks.
Such a nasty one.
Plus, female has more hormones. She could start a war in 10 seconds. If she has hot flashes, whatever, boom.
That was a teaser I did for Aphex, for a gig we did in Texas. And you guys probably know me most because it's it's nice that event for this gig. And I guess the kind of main inspiration for why I do the things in this show came from, unsurprisingly, a gig that I was at back in 96. And yeah, like, it kind of really inspired me because it was just so wrong, but yeah, right. And yeah, it was like in October, and I think the weekend before I was in the forest looking for mushrooms, so it was like, in a perfect state of mind for this. And yeah, I mean, this set, I mean, forget about being knocked sideways. My brain was literally diagonal after that. But anyway, it was really cool. And I'd been a fan for him for about 3 years by that point. And I kind of wondered why I'd not seen him before, but he hadn't done gigs for 3 years, so that kind of explained it. I realised that when I got that interview. But he had, like, that on stage. And it was like, I couldn't really find much footage because it's really a long time ago, but he was like also like laid down on stage, which was completely undone then. And then later on, he also just got a cigar and he was like being filmed, and that was the projections. And he also had his teddies on stage just like fighting and all that, but I just wanted to recreate that in the visuals basically. So fast forward a few years and I kind of moved to London in about 99, and I kind of hooked up with this two Japanese people, like a Japanese couple, and they were kind of doing visuals, and we started this thing called RGB Invaded. And I was using this software that they had from Japan, where it's a bit like VJam that Coca had at the time, where you basically assign a clip and like a blend mode or a kind of effect on each key. So you kind of do this, a bit like that game where you've got to kind of get into a certain position, but I get all my fingers like that, and then you're like, oh no, I want to get to this button, so you end up using your nose or whatever kind of thing. And I was playing quite a lot in squat parties, and I don't know if you've been to many of those, but it's pretty hard to keep it together just being there. Like, so like trying to do this was pretty messy. But a few years later, I kind of started my own night called New Bleep. And I actually did that before bleep.com, but it was kind of based on, I was really into new beats, and then I was really into the microchip scene, so I kind of combined the two kind of vibes. But for this thing, it was kind of the first time I kind of did a lot of stuff with live input. So I couldn't really find any better pictures. I know I've got them somewhere, but it's backed up somewhere on a CD, and no idea where. But the vibe was to get computer games set up, and the crowd would play it, and the kind of the visuals from the game would get fed into the actual visuals projected on all the TVs and projection, and the sound of the games would go into the, you know, would feed into the music that people were making. So the kind of crowd interaction kind of started there, and that's kind of some of the visuals that I did back then. But like, just through doing those kind of nights, it was really good to network and kind of meet new people. And because, yeah, if you want to kind of get more gigs when you kind of start out when you move here, like I find doing events is quite good. You probably lose loads of money and stress and sleep and all that, but the kind of contacts, the good contacts, come through doing that if you're into it. So I started doing stuff with, a lot of stuff with Warp. So I did this for Mira Kalix at the Hayward and various things for her. Through this promoter called Joanne Segura, who was going out with Aphex at the time. So that was pretty alright. And then a lot of the stuff I did for visuals ended up as a music video on Warp. And then played at quite a lot of the Warp parties, like this thing. And yeah, and this was all live. I'm really into just doing stuff totally live, so I'm just throwing a few PNGs of like pin-up girls, and the rest is all just processed in real time. Like on the kind of crappy laptop that we had back then. And then I did another thing for Joanna where it was on election night in 2005, and I did a thing where the whole visuals for the night was basically getting a feed from the TV, and you know on election night they just have the election results and all that the whole night, and they just processed it to the music for the whole night basically. And then I did this piece when I was just in my bedroom playing about with my new mate. But we all lived together in the same house in St. Newton. And I spent many days, nights, just doing random stuff like that. Anyway, you get the vibe. And it kind of led on to doing work with Maya, who kind of spotted it. and I did all the kind of graphics in the back kind of thing. And I thought, wow, yeah, so now working with big name kind of wire thing, I thought, yeah, it's going to lead on to loads of other work. But it did, but it took quite a few years. So then I kind of did this piece, and it's kind of a piece I did for, sorry, I'll turn it off. I did it for Joanna Seguro again, and she wanted a thing to, where's the thing? I'm trying to skip through the, oh, sorry. Yeah, she just wanted a thing where it was at the beginning of the event and it was just a test card that just kind of like changed throughout the whole time. And it's just a test card that evolves and it had no sound, so it was great for the event, but then I really wanted to put it online. So I got a lot of my friends to do the soundtrack, and if it was 8 different sections, I got 8 different friends to do it. But then, like, how am I going to coordinate 8 different friends to do a specific bit? So I kind of did this thing, like, you know that game when... I used to do a lot with my dad when I was on train journeys and stuff, where you just draw, like, the head, and then you fold it over, and then you draw the next bit. Do you know the one I mean? Like, yeah. And I did that with sound, where I just gave the bit that they were going to do, but without showing them what the rest was, or telling them who was doing the next thing, and this is how it came out. Trying to go to the next bit. Oh, anyway. So this kind of led on to, it's on my website so you can check it out anytime. This led on to Richard seeing this piece and he wanted visuals at the time. And he was like, yeah, I'll have some of that, basically. And I did that. So I used the same kind of techniques as the Nair, but I did it in a live way. And so like the things you see out there is how I do that live. So those bits just get multiplied and spiraled in various ways, basically. And it's all totally live. And we kind of discussed doing other things. So I went to the Warp office to get these masks to do visuals with and did stuff like that. And it's at that point that I was like, oh, this is happening for sure, because it just came out totally out of the blue and I just had 1 month to do it. And I was like, this is so cool. Like, but I was like, it's so good. I was like, is it actually happening? And I spoke to him on the phone and I was like, but he's a bit of a prankster. So I was like, you know, is this happening for sure? But then once I went there to the Warp office and got the masks, I was like, yeah, it's happening for sure now. But it was, which was great relief, but then it was really daunting to like, shit, I've only got like over 3 weeks to just put up this whole show, because that whole TR3 thing was not live at all and I had to make it all. But, you know, had to do it really, right? And did loads of stuff like that with the mask that I'd made into 3D. And I started messing about with a lot of his artwork stuff. Because he's got a whole theme of like using his face for everything, so I thought it'd be quite suitable really. And doing it all with sound reactive elements. But Richard had tons of... Oh yeah, no, I know. Use it a bit more. And throwing his kind of teddies in there as well. But Richard's got loads of these random pictures that I just threw in as well and did the same kind of effect to it. And he just sent me loads more pictures. So yeah, okay, let's just do it, come up in there. And then also, on that first tour, he was playing with Florian Hecker, and I don't know if you know this guy, but I was a big fan of his as well. And this guy does full-on iArt kind of sound installations, and he was dealing with the kind of sound reactive side of it. Not sound reactive, the surround sound. And I asked him what he wanted for the visuals, and he was like, oh yeah, there's this auction going on at the moment because Yves Saint Laurent has just passed away and he's selling all his art. So I was like, okay, well, so made something with that as well. And I mean, there's loads more that I could go on about that tour, but I've got to move on to the next year. So the next year, I thought, okay, I'll just refine. I've got loads more time now. I can just refine it all, it'll be good. So I kind of thought, oh yeah, I'll just bring in some kind of 360 pictures of like Cornwall, because that features in his artwork as well, and just play about with that. And then like a week before the first show, Richard was like, okay, I just want visuals that's all just filming the crowd. And standing here, I can see where he's coming from now, actually, because it kind of would reflect the attention back onto the crowd, rather than just being focused on him. So I was like, okay, so I'll do that. So all these nights that I did before, like New Bleep and that 555, just came in handy, because I just started kind of just filming the crowd. But we had no time to prepare for that at all. So I was just like getting someone to have my DV cam to just film someone in infrared light, which worked out okay. But then I found it was for the Pompidou in Metz opening. You know, like we've got like Tate Modern, but there's like Tate Cornwall and Tate Liverpool. But they've got like this new one in Pompidou thing in kind of Met. And I realised that they'd actually done a big opening before because things got delayed. And the one before they had Roger Kida doing the opening. And I'm a big fan of his as well. And I know that his stuff would have been so ultra tight. And we just turned up doing this random whatever, like. But it worked out all right. No one ever complains to Richard, so it's, yeah, it's fine. So for the next shows, I did a bit more stuff. Part of it. But it never quite feel like I really nailed it. So I kind of started using like computer vision, which is like, you know, face mapping and stuff like that, which is quite common now with all the Snapchats and all that, but back then it was not that used really. So it was at an event in Victoria Park, Capital Day, and I did the premiere of that, and it worked out pretty good. Is anyone at that gig? And then later that year, I kind of did it in Rome. And we started doing a bit more kind of 3D face mapping. And then in 2011, I was like, okay, I've got to top that somehow. Well, not really top it, but I do just make it evolve. And straight after that gig, I went to Japan and like, you know, like those kind of things you set seaside towns? In Japan, they've got them everywhere. And then I just saw that. This is my kids, actually, by the way. So I'm actually showing you like holiday photos. And I saw that and I thought, yeah, okay, I'll use that in the show. But I mean, the fact that I got inspired by that is kind of really relevant to my work because I kind of used it in that way for the show. But I tend to, although my work is really, really digital, I tend to try and get inspired by non-digital stuff. So I tend to be inspired when I'm on a move or, you know, if I've got to work with certain artists and I'm going on holiday, I'll just make sure they give me a brief before, then I'll just figure out whilst I'm away. But can't really be on a holiday the whole time. So, you know, I often get inspired when I'm just in the shower or stuff like that, which means I end up having really long showers. But I also have got tons of books and I try and just get inspired by non-digital stuff. Because otherwise, it's so easy to just copy and paste that, you know, I think it's best to keep up to date with all the digital plugins and tutorials and softwares, but try to get inspired by something that's not digital, because, yeah, it just breaks a loop somehow. So anyway, I did that, where I, instead of putting Richard's face onto the crowd, I'm just taking the crowd's face and just putting it onto these random pictures. But then I thought, okay, I'll take it one step further. And, because he only does one gig here and there, like one gig in this country, one gig there in this other country. I'll do it in a way that it's customized for each country. And I'm really into that as well. I always try and do something that's so specific for a particular project. So I kind of started doing it for each country. And I thought it went down well, but it went down super well. This is one we did in Finland. And they're actually cheering to the visuals. And which kind of throws Richard off, because he's like, you know, he's playing great tunes, but nothing particularly special at that point. And they're just like going, yeah. So kind of a weird patriotic thing going on, but it's just, yeah, it's great. And then we did this one in Lowlands, and it worked pretty good as well. And the thing with that gig as well, it was a double whammy for me, because there was a kind of miscommunication where the promoters thought that the face mapping stuff wasn't working. And they were like, oh no, this is like a big deal. We thought like Aphex was going to do his face mapping thing. But it kind of shows that, you know, there was something fairly special that the promoters would be bothered about the visuals thing when it's mainly about the music. But anyway, so then for the next stage, like I thought the best way that it's evolved into this current form was with the stage design. And basically in 2010, it was just like one big screen and maybe a plasma or maybe three screens at the back. And then in 2010-11, it was a bit more kind of designed and still worked pretty good. Like. And then in 2012, where we just mainly toured in Australia, it was six big equal size screens. And then more recently we did it in Texas, and it was a bit more kind of coordinated with the light, and it's a bit more kind of random, and it's less like a cinema screen. And this show that you're kind of probably more familiar with. And the way that it's done is basically, I'm connected to the lighting desk by ArtNet, and the lighting guy just controls what screen goes on and off. And it just makes it a lot more dynamic, I think. And you'd think that, because I'm now controlling like 12 to 14 screens, that the hardware setup would be a lot more complex, but it's not really. Like, this is 2009, and this is pretty generic VJ kind of setup kind of thing. It's not too bad. But then we move on to this thing, and it's just like, oh my God, like, it just gives me like bad flashbacks just even looking at it. Like, and I think the main reason is because we're split into like loads of different kind of screens. Like, there's projector and there's plasmas, and we're using multiple computers. But then when we switch to just LED screens, it simplifies a bit more, and then it's this, which is like just some kind of minimalistic kind of design kind of thing. And the main key is just having this connection with the lighting desk and having audio reactive stuff. And it just makes it so much more easy to set up, really. And for the NTS show, it was marginally more complex, but pretty straightforward. And the way that I kind of split into multiple screens, we do this thing called pixel mapping, where this is just one big HD output, and it all gets split up to the different screens, because LEDs are pretty low res, really. And just do that. But then what I tend to do is I kind of do this live reconfiguration of the screens in various different ways, and it just makes it dynamic, and then the lighting guy just turns them on and off. This is like a technical drawing of the setup, and this is the same kind of thing with all the lasers. Richard really likes lasers, so yeah. And then I think like this kind of recent show is a kind of combination of the best of all the shows that we've done before, where it's a mixture of all the kind of playful 3D stuff that we did in 2009 and a lot of the kind of crowd visuals. And another thing that we do is the lighting guy has control over what screen is on, but also he controls the lighting within the 3D scene. So all the lighting and shading is all controlled by him as well, but it's not quite obvious yet during the visuals. So I'm going to try and work on that. So I think a lot of my kind of stuff is really quite punk, and I work for a lot of quite punk kind of clients. Because I find if they're not that punk, I mean, when I say punk, I don't mean like we've got Mohicans and we listen to Sex Pistols, but I mean the kind of punk attitude. And I find if they're not got this punk edge to it, it doesn't tend to work out too well for you. But like this is some other kind of visual things that I did for Richard kind of thing. But it's kind of got, it's going into kind of similar aesthetics to what I do with another artist that I work with quite a lot, and this is Maya. Anyway, so yeah, this is the latest thing I did for Maya. So I do quite a lot of collaboration with a lot of people, like Maya, and I've done a lot of stuff with Di Martel and kind of Sophie Muller, and it works quite well when I work with more mature kind of people that are not so familiar with technology, but I bring in the technology edge. But with Maya, yeah, it's kind of this collaborative thing where we come from quite different backgrounds and she's got really different tastes to me. So it kind of works where she comes up with this idea and then it's kind of really different thing, and what comes up is something that I would never think of ever kind of thing, where it's quite different to what I do with Aphex, where we've got quite similar tastes. And he just kind of throws me in this direction where I get the most of what I usually do. And they're both quite punk, and it's quite, they've got a punk in quite different ways, because like, what's really challenging with the Aphex shows is that it's really technical, and it's really, like there's so many things that could go wrong. But the actual figuring out what he wants is really quite simple. But with Maya, you know, the show is quite a picnic in comparison, but like her kind of taste changes all the time on a daily kind of basis. So it's really hard to keep up, but I found after working with both of them for nearly 10 years now that it's made me a better designer, you know, to try and keep up with their thing. And yeah, because I've kind of taken you on a bit of a tour of where I come from and all that, I just thought I'd mention what I'm doing next kind of thing. So I've been kind of working with this director called Brian Welsh, which I don't know if you've heard of him. I hadn't at all. But when I met him, I was totally starstruck, because although I've met quite a lot of pop stars and famous people over the years, when I found out that he was one of the directors of my favorite Black Mirror episode, or the one, you know, the one when they've all got lenses and everything's stored on their kind of back there, do you know what I mean? Anyway, directed that, and when I found out, oh my God, I didn't know what to do with myself, like. And like, so he's doing this film where it's all like set in the kind of early 90s, and it's all about these kids going raving. And like, this is exactly what I used to do back then, and it's pretty crazy that all my experiences of doing that kind of stuff back then is now being useful. So I'm kind of doing these visuals like that are in the style of what's back then, and I'm kind of going to be doing, you know, the styling of how it is when they're like intoxicated kind of thing. So I'm looking forward to that. And then I'm also going to be doing visuals with Aphex in Fuji Rock. And whilst I'm there, I'm going to be working on a video for Young Juvenile Youth, who does pretty cool videos. And these two, which are just so only in Japan kind of thing, really. So yeah, that should be quite interesting. And then at the weekend, I was just talking to the people from Wave VR. So they're doing this thing where they want to create like a VR club thing, which I think once VR becomes mainstream, which it's bound to happen as soon as Apple brings out their VR set, that everyone, well, not everyone, but a lot of people will be like clubbing in a virtual environment. So hopefully I'll be doing a lot of that by that point. And yeah, that's about it, really. So thanks a lot.